Realm presents Orphan Black, The Next Chapter, starring Tatiana Maslany. Episode 11.
Where is she?
Sarah paced the living room. Clonedom was public. Scientists were engineering fatal diseases, and Kira wasn't calling.
Where the fuck is Felix? He should have called by now.
Cosima, not feeling quite up to Sarah's particular brand of electrostatic at the moment, edged her way into the kitchen and sniffed the air.
What's that?
She asked, leaning over the counter toward Delphine.
Some cookies.
Delphine said, pushing an edge of sweaty hair out of her face with the back of her hand and flushing slightly.
I couldn't reach anyone at the task force, and I can't think of anything else helpful to do, so I think this is what they call stress baking.
That sounds like a great stress reaction, Cosima purred. How long do we have before they're ready?
Oh, Delphine looked at the timer. 15 minutes?
Maybe we could... Cosima's suggestion was interrupted by a shriek from the living room. She combined concern and exasperation in a single exchange of glances with Delphine and tore into the next room.
That's where she is, isn't it? That's where she is, and they're having a fucking anti-clone riot there.
Cosima shifted her attention from Sarah's screams to the television. The screen showed the bouncy, low-quality footage of a bystander's cell phone taking in a mob of angry people in a blizzard and... Oh, goddess, yes, there was a clone. Dana, with a gun to her head.
Oh, shit.
Someone breathed next to Cosima, but she couldn't tear her eyes away from the screen. Then there was Vivi, walking up slowly, and the crowd seemed to be pulsing with anger. Someone screamed out of frame. The footage jumped and bounced and then cut off.
Fuck, Cosima breathed. Who knows how long ago that even happened?
Sarah yelled, shaking Allison off.
She still hasn't called. I'm going out there. Hey, it'll take hours to drive.
Cosima's attempt at calm and rational was derailed when Delphine squeaked and grabbed her arm.
That's Eloise. General Thibault, I mean.
Cosima turned back to the television, where a robust older woman was holding forth to the anchor on a stage set.
That's the one from that important task force thing? She asked.
The group that endorsed the biometric security? Delphine waved the snark away.
She's practically my only ally on the task force. She is in the military, so of course she doesn't completely get it, but at least she listens.
She stopped talking, staring at the TV.
As I said,
the general was explaining.
While we don't know yet the full story of what caused violence to break out in this peaceful village, it is clear from this clip that the clones are inciting unrest.
Oi!
Sarah yelled at the screen.
And it's past time for the Canadian government to do something about it. We cannot let these unknown figures, who may have a foreign agenda even embedded in their DNA.
Everyone was yelling now.
We must take a stand and investigate exactly what is going on here.
Just turn it off!
Allison shrieked.
No!
The others shouted as one.
We need to know what's going on,
Cosima said.
I don't understand,
Delphine muttered.
She seemed sympathetic.
Sarah was pacing again.
Kira could have been caught in the middle of that riot. Cos,
Sarah said.
Cos, you've got to call her. She won't answer if it's from me.
Cosima pulled out her phone, set it on speaker, and punched in Kira's name. It rang once before she picked up.
We did it! We did it!
Kira!
Cosima cut through her excited squeals.
Are you okay?
Yes, Aunt Cos, I'm fine.
Then talk to your mom. I'm not going to cover for you anymore.
Cosima handed the phone to Sarah, who took it as if it might explode on her.
Hello?
Hey, Mom.
Kira sounded more resigned than enthusiastic, but at least she was talking.
Kira.
Sarah exhaled, her daughter's name collapsing into the sofa.
Are you okay?
I'm fine, Mom.
The eye roll was almost audible through the phone.
We saved the village and their genome, and we're on our way home. Just...
Sarah had her hand over her eyes, whether because she was overcome with emotion or because she was as annoyed as Cosima was by phrases like the village and their genome.
Kira, she broke in. Kira, listen to me. The showing footage on the news of a riot there, with Dana and Vivi in the middle of it.
There was a beat of silence.
That did sort of happen, but they're okay, and...
There was a pause. Felix's voice said something indecipherable in the background.
Kira?
Sarah said, her voice cracking.
Can you just come home, please?
A longer pause. Cosima imagined Felix giving Kira a look.
Mom, we're already on the way. We've been on the road for hours. We'll be there in...
There was a brief pause while Kira and Felix could be heard arguing the accuracy of the GPS.
Maybe 1 or 2 hours, depending on traffic. Maybe we can talk about this then.
She sounded tired suddenly, and Cosima felt an ominous shiver run through her. What had happened? The connection clicked off. Allison sat down next to Sarah and started rubbing her back.
Eloise must have gotten the wrong information about this riot, Delphine said.
Cosima glared at her, fear shifting into anger. If she didn't have all the information, she shouldn't have been on TV talking about it.
I know her, Delphine protested. She is not a bigot. It must be some kind of misunderstanding.
Well, it's a fucking dangerous one,
Sarah said from behind her hands.
I'm going to go talk to her,
Delphine said, whirling toward the door.
What?
Cosima followed her wife to the hall where she was pulling on her warmest parka.
You're going to talk to her now?
Sarah is right. The longer this accusation is out there, from a government official, the more dangerous it becomes for you, for all of you.
Do you want me to come?
Delphine spun around, swinging a scarf around her neck.
No, chérie. Remember, everyone will recognize you as a clone now. Do you really want to walk into a live television recording studio?
Cosima didn't.
Besides,
Delphine went on, flipping her hair out from under her scarf.
Eloise and I have a rapport. I can talk to her. Maybe I can even get the studio to put me on the air to talk about the ethics and set the record straight.
She dropped a quick kiss on Cosima's cheek and pushed open the door.
Okay, well, good luck then,
Cosima said. Jessetta hesitated on the doorstep of what she was starting to think of as Clone Mansion. Maybe she should have gone straight to the RCMP instead and tried to get them to throw the full weight of their resources into getting Art back. But that would mean talking them into believing her over a high-ranking U.S. intelligence officer with all the right code clearances and an unfortunately plausible story about a rogue spy that they'd already bought into once. An intelligence officer who already had a connection with her bosses, whom they had no reason to disbelieve, and who could threaten them with an embarrassing diplomatic incident, at a minimum, if they acted on her claims. Absurd as it seemed, Jacetta was pretty sure that a group of civilian clones had a better chance of saving Art's life. Still, she hesitated. She didn't want to see the expressions on their identical faces when she told them Art had been taken.
Come on,
she muttered to herself.
Standing here isn't helping them. Besides, this smarter-than-thou house has probably already seen you and told them you're here.
She grabbed the ridiculous yet undeniably appealing bell pull and yanked. The door opened to reveal Cosima, but with straight hair and bangs. Not Cosima. When was Jacetta going to get used to this?
And what was this one's name?
Oh, it's you, the clone said. The woman said, Jacetta corrected herself. Was clone a slur or just a statement? This was a whole new set of identity issues the world was going to have to learn to navigate.
Can I come in? It's important.
The woman, Allison, that was it, stepped out of the way and then shut the door behind her. In the living room, Cosima was sitting with another identical, the one with the British accent who always looked ready to thump someone, Sarah.
Oh, hi,
Cosima said. At least she didn't sound hostile. Yet.
What's going on? Where's Art?
She sounded curious, not worried, but it still hit Jacetta like an accusation.
Art's been taken, she said, trying to imagine she was reporting this to her RCMP boss instead of Art's friends.
He was backing me up on a meet with this CIA guy, Davis, and the target got the drop on us. The clones were both on their feet now, and Sarah was moving quickly into Jayaseta's space.
Wait a second. Art was backing you up, and you let them take him away?
Cosima laid a hand on Sarah's arm, but Jayaseta hadn't flinched. She deserved this.
I thought it was a friendly meet, a way to get more information. It wasn't. He had extra muscle there, and they got Art into a car, and I couldn't keep up.
Sarah threw her hands up in the air.
So we have to go off to the fucking CIA now.
But she was yelling it into the ceiling rather than at Jayaseta.
What did you learn?
Cosima asked, but Jayaseta held up a hand.
I'm not finished. He wants Vivi to bring the weapon in exchange for Art.
Cosima and Sarah's eyebrows rose in eerie tandem. Jayaseta wondered if Allison's were doing the same behind her.
I got a tracker into their car. They're in a condo about half an hour from here. 10 minutes ago, he sent me a text with the address and apartment number, reiterating that only Vivi is to bring the weapon.
The silence that followed was pierced by a shrill beeping.
What the fucking fuck is that?
Sarah yelled.
It's the smoke alarm,
Allison diagnosed crisply, coming into the room.
Cosima, did you leave a joint burning somewhere?
Cosima rolled her eyes at her.
No, it must be... Oh, shit! Delphine's cookies!
She turned and ran into the next room. Allison gave Jayaseta and Sarah an exasperated look, and the three of them followed. The kitchen was smoggy and acrid. Sarah heaved open a window while Cosima opened the stove door on a blackened mess.
Let's hope the paparazzi aren't still staking out the house,
she said as she pulled on an oven mitt.
Clones conducting Viking funeral,
Allison offered between coughs.
Footage at 11. Clones in epic flamethrower battle immolate half of Toronto's trendy Trinity Bellwoods neighborhood,
Cosima said.
All right, Sarah said, turning back from the window. Can we go back to talking about how...
She had to pause for a cough and continued, eyes watering.
How Art is in trouble and how exactly we're going to help him.
Greenhouse...
Cosima rasped, waving, and they escaped the kitchen into a steamy, overgrown, glassed-in annex. Jayaseta got started.
Where is Vivi now?
You're not going to trade her, Cosima said.
No, of course not,
Jayaseta retorted, although she caught a look on Sarah's face that made her think, for that clone at least, assassin spy for trusted friend might seem like a good bargain.
But she knows this guy, or at the very least, she knows the organization. She will have a far better idea than we do of what he's after and what his weak points might be.
The clones looked at each other.
Vivi's on her way back from Quebec, Cosima said at last. They should be here soon-ish, if Kira's estimate was accurate, she added, glancing at Sarah, who bounced to her feet and began to pace again.
We can't wait that long, Sarah said. You all know how many times Art saved my ass. We can't just leave him there.
We do have some experience with this sort of thing, you know,
Allison said, managing to sound prim as she did.
I can wake up Donnie and...
We don't have any experience with the CIA,
Cosima said. She shivered, and Jayaseta wondered if she were remembering her recent experience with the darker side of Canadian government.
Give me the address, Sarah said. I'll go check it out.
Sarah, Allison said firmly, do remember that we are the most recognizable people on Earth right now.
Cosima glanced at the TARDIS-shaped clock on the wall.
It's at least worth talking to Vivi about it.
We wait,
Jayaseta said. Spy versus spy was the best strategy she could see. There was a silence. In the quiet, Cosima picked up a blown glass bong and lit it.
So, how's it coming with the investigation of the murder you arrested me for?
She asked, after a toke. Allison snorted. Jayaseta didn't mind. Anything that distracted her from what might be happening to Art was welcome. She cast her mind back to the latest files she had seen, the last time she had been in the office, before she had known that human clones existed, a lifetime ago. You've been formally exonerated, if you care. It's not just the identity confusion Forensics came back, along with a more careful examination of the scene, and determined that the bullet that killed Sturgis came from outside the apartment.
Oh, Sarah said, smirking. So, if you lot had done your job right from the start, you'd never have had Cosima in the interrogation room to get snatched in the first place.
She was at the scene, covered in blood, and on the surveillance cameras holding a gun to his head. Giacetta replied evenly. She was going to be interrogated no matter what. Cosima waved her hand at them.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Where did the shot come from?
The roof of a nearby building, Giacetta said. Sniper-level shooting, and the bullet was typical of Canadian military snipers as well. Although, of course, it's more widely available than that.
Could it have been Davis?
Sarah asked, chewing on the side of her thumb. Giacetta shook her head. He didn't arrive in Canada until after Sturgis was shot.
Unless he did something sneaky with his passport,
Sarah offered, looking around.
He's a spy, right?
Charlotte had an encounter with him in the hospital right around then, Allison said.
So there's someone else out to get us, Sarah asked, and your lot haven't figured out who yet.
Her laser focus was turned on Giacetta, who sighed and pulled out her mobile. She should check in anyway.
It's Priyantha, she told the receptionist.
Can you put Martinez on? Martinez, what's the status on the Sturgis shooting? Any new?
What?
Wait.
Who?
She listened, thanked Martinez, and hung up to see three identical expressions facing her. Well, maybe not totally identical. Cosima looked a little more stoned and Sarah a little more pissed.
Okay,
Giacetta said. They probably had a right to know, and if not, she was in too deep at this point to care. So my colleague got a call an hour ago from some cops in Quebec, the ones who responded to the incident in the village. Sarah hissed, drawing Giacetta's eye, but didn't interrupt. They arrested a bunch of yahoos, their phrase, with way too many weapons. The leader kept yelling about how he worked for the Ministry of Defense, and they didn't know who he was, so they called MOD, which said he had been terminated as of this morning. Giacetta glanced at Cosima. He told them his name was Greg Kurtzman, and once they told him he'd been cut loose, apparently he was furious, started spilling everything. He told them the whole thing had been planned by his boss. He even... Giacetta paused for effect. She couldn't help herself. Tried to pin the Sturgis killing on her. Of course, this might not be true. He might just be trying to weasel out of taking the fall himself. We'll have to get him in, check his knowledge of the details.
Wait.
Cosimo is standing now, the bong shattering at her feet.
What's his boss's name?
His boss was General Eloise Thibault. She's a decorated... But before Giacetta could finish the thumbnail bio Martinez had given her in a skeptical tone, Cosima was halfway out the door.
Cause. Sarah grabbed her arm. You heard what Giacetta said. This guy could be full of shit.
Besides, Allison chimed in, it's not like Delphine is meeting her in some dark alley. She's in a television studio, for heaven's sake. Cosima shook them both off.
I have to go. I'm sorry. Call me. Let me know what you decide to do about art, if I can help, but I have to go.
Cosima! Jay rushed after her into the hallway.
Let me help.
By the time they hit Toronto traffic, the atmosphere in Uncle Fee's Prius was tense, would be a gentle way to put it. Ever since the phone call, Uncle Felix had been giving Kira a hard time for not letting her mom know she was safe as soon as the fighting was over. Finally, Kira had lashed out and asked why he hadn't called, and now he was sulking, and she was feeling guilty about fighting with her favorite uncle. All of her triumph over the success at the village had evaporated. Dana, meanwhile, was curled up silently in the rear seat, staring out the window at the snow. At least the weather had eased somewhat when they pulled up to Chez Coffin. Kira lingered for a moment in the cold, hoping that one of the others would lead the way so that at least she wouldn't have to make the big entrance. But Uncle Fee put his arm around her shoulders, gave her an avuncular squeeze, and walked her up to the door by his side with Dana trailing behind. The door opened for her, of course, and her mom was there almost before it had closed again. She threw her arms around Kira. She had to admit, it felt good. Then it went on too long, Finally, she let go, just before Kira was going to absolutely have to give up and squirm.
I'm so proud of you,
she whispered, cupping Kira's face, then paused.
What's wrong?
And just like that, all the confusion and frustration Kira had been feeling during that endless car ride bubbled up and caught in her throat as her mom led her and the others into the living room.
It's just, it went well. We did it, but Vivi.
What happened to Valdez? That was from a South Asian woman Kira didn't know, pushing out past Allison.
Where is she?
Kira swallowed, aware of her mother watching her intensely, and it was Dana who answered.
She's gone.
What do you mean, gone? Allison asked.
Was she?
Of course, Allison didn't want to say the word killed.
She disappeared after the riot,
Felix said with his usual calm matter-of-factness as he shed his coat.
The blizzard was much worse up there, and it's possible she got lost, but I'm sure she's fine.
We thought we had managed everything. Kira could feel the words spilling out of her, almost like an apology.
Vivi was amazing. She just knew what to do, and We got the mosquitoes to stop working, and then I looked up, and I didn't even notice she was gone.
Her mom pulled her close again, and Kira was fighting tears so hard she couldn't even resent it.
Monkey, Vivi is a well-trained professional spy,
Sarah murmured.
She can probably take care of herself.
Kira pulled back, shaking her head.
She could have been hurt or captured by someone we didn't see or gotten lost in the snow. We shouldn't have left her.
We didn't, Felix cut in, his voice edged with the remnants of having had this argument over and over in the car.
Helena stayed behind to search for her. See?
Sarah was still totally focused on Kira, which felt like it hadn't happened in a while.
We'll find her. No one can evade Helena for long.
Kira managed to return Sarah's smile, and then Dana spoke.
If Vivi got lost, it was because she wanted to. And she's gonna stay lost. She doesn't want anything to do with us.
Kira turned to see that the young clone was close to tears.
I'm sorry. I always felt pretty good about our upbringing, you know, like it was fucked up, but I always had my cousins and I always knew why it was fucked up and I thought our parents did a decent job. But Vivi was totally shut out of all of that. And now it's too late. She doesn't even want to know us.
Dana's tears spilled over.
I'm sorry,
she said again.
Is there somewhere I can go to just lie down? I'm exhausted.
Of course!
Allison bustled forward, casting a quick glance around at the rest of them as she put her arm around Dana's shoulders.
Was it bad out there?
Sarah asked as they watched Allison lead Dana up the stairs.
Dana had a rough time of it,
Kira said and took a shaky breath.
But I'm really fine, Mom, and you're right, Vivi probably is too. That's right.
Sarah pulled her in for another hug, a quick one this time. Kira was almost feeling good as she disentangled herself. She was about to say that she was going to find a bed herself, but Sarah stopped her with a hand on her arm.
Kira, Charlotte's here. She told us what you two did.
Kira froze, and she could feel all her defenses rising again. Sarah must have seen it because she sounded almost desperate.
Can you just tell me about it. I want to understand.
Really?
That came out more skeptically than Kira intended.
Yes, really,
Sarah said firmly.
I always wanted to protect you from all the clone stuff. I never really thought we could do that any other way.
Kira bit back her sharp retort.
And I'm not entirely convinced now this was a good idea, mind,
Sarah went on.
But I want to know why you think so.
That's it, Jayasada said. I'm going back to the RCMP. She had spent the past 30 minutes while Felix offered a dramatic rendition of the events in Quebec, trying to think of a better plan. She hadn't come up with anything.
No!
Allison looked horrified.
Why?
Why?
Vivi is in the wind. I have nothing to bargain with and no particular expertise on espionage or whatever this creeper's deal is. And Art's life is in the balance.
Wait, come again, Felix said. Jay quickly brought the Quebec team up to speed on her disastrous meeting with Davis and his demand for Valdez in exchange for Art's release.
We have to go after my dad ourselves now.
Charlotte had woken from her nap and was sitting on the sofa, with Allison and Donnie like bulwarks to either side of her. Jay could see that her hands were trembling, but her voice was steady.
Charlotte?
Allison said so gently that Jay almost winced.
You're recovering from a serious illness. You're not going to...
Yes, I am. Charlotte twisted in her seat.
I thought we had this conversation. You can't keep sidelining me because I'm younger.
Allison started to say something, and Charlotte cut her off.
Or because of my leg. Don't give me that putting myself in danger argument, Aunt Allison. I've studied martial arts for 8 years. I'm a better fighter than you are.
She's right.
Jacetta turned to see Sarah coming back down the stairs from wherever she had gone with her daughter.
Charlotte's an adult now. Odd as that is to believe.
Sarah ruffled the young clone's hair as she made her way over to the armchair.
She has a part in this.
Not that it matters. Jacetta had decided it was time to take control of the discussion again.
Since I'm going to the RCMP, and none of you are going to do anything stupid.
You think they'll believe you?
Sarah was leaning forward, elbows on her knees, eyes piercing into Jacetta's. At least I don't have to convince them that clones are real, Jacetta pointed out. You're not in hiding anymore, Sarah. We can go to the authorities.
This guy we're up against is the authorities, Sarah said. And what's his con? What's Davis telling them to convince them he's a good guy?
That they had a U.S. spy here who had gone rogue.
And she has gone rogue now, hasn't she? Has anyone in the Mounties met Vivi besides you?
Jacetta shook her head.
How long do you think it's going to take to convince your bosses that the bad guy is the high-ranking U.S. counterpart and not the...
Sarah hesitated for a second.
Clone.
Jacetta also hesitated. And before she could figure out what to say next, Allison had taken over.
Sarah, I know you're still upset about what Kira and Charlotte did,
Allison said. Jacetta looked up in surprise, and Sarah started to say something, but Allison cut them both off.
But I was meditating on it last night, and I really think we need to reframe our mindset. We're so used to thinking of being known as clones as a liability.
Allison nodded decisively.
It's time we make it an asset.
The receptionist at the TV studio was helpful when Delphine explained she was a colleague of General Thibault's, bringing her some data for her next segment. It was true enough, Delphine thought, following the directions through a maze of cubicles, green rooms, and sets seen through soundproof glass windows. Eloise needed some data, like that clones were people and that civil liberties still existed, and not to jump to conclusions based on limited information. She couldn't quite shake the uneasy feeling that Eloise knew all that. What was she playing at? And what exactly was Delphine going to say to her when she found her?
Don't be a bigot. Someone gave you bad information and you need to correct it. I need your help.
Finally, she found the door to the green room to Studio C. Delphine paused for a deep breath before opening the door. The general was standing with her back to the doorway, watching a television screen that echoed the action on a brilliantly lit talk show, visible through the plate glass window to the studio proper.
General,
Delphine said, slipping into the French pronunciation automatically as an extra layer of privacy. Eloise turned.
Dr. Cormier,
she said in surprise, and went on in French.
What are you doing here? Do you have an interview scheduled?
In fact, I came to talk to you about your earlier interview, about the incident in Quebec.
A young woman in a chic suit squeezed past Delphine and leaned into the room. 10 minutes, Miss Thibault.
It's General,
Eloise said, without heat and without taking her eyes from Delphine, but the woman was already gone. Since Eloise didn't volunteer anything, Delphine tried again.
Whatever happened in that village, we both know it wasn't the clones that instigated it.
Eloise narrowed her eyes.
How do you know?
She barked.
Was your wife one of the clones there?
No.
Delphine felt a shiver of fear and tried to lighten the mood.
There are a lot of clones, you know. Not all of them know each other any more than all francophones do.
Eloise's delicate eyebrows snapped together.
We may not all know each other, but everyone else thinks we do. Let me tell you something about that village in Quebec.
she growled.
It's full of traitorous terrorists. Terrorists who perpetrate violence on the state. Who don't even want to be Canadian. Believe me, they give all Francophones a bad name. They make it impossible for all of us who are loyal citizens.
Delphine paused, trying to make sense of that.
Bien,
she said uncertainly.
But if they are so violent, that makes it even less likely that the clones instigated the riot.
Oh, yes.
Eloise nodded as if she were just remembering a minor detail.
Well, that's what we saw in the video. And we don't know exactly what the clones are up to. What is their agenda? Why do they keep...
She cast about for a word.
Getting involved.
General.
Delphine said, trying to get Eloise into the professional mindset. Remind her of the competent, apparently sane person she was in the task force meetings.
You must understand that when you say things about the clones being dangerous, it puts them in danger.
She had been wrong about Eloise, Delphine thought. Very, very wrong.
But clones are dangerous.
Eloise was speaking softly now, approaching Delphine step by step.
Surely, as an ethicist, you can see that.
Delphine took a deep breath to start a nuanced response about the distinction between having ethical qualms about the origins of clones and treating them like human beings, but Eloise wasn't done.
You understand the risks. Our biometric security, for example. It can find the clones, but it can't tell us which one is which.
Delphine shook her head.
You know I don't agree with the biometrics in the first place.
They are evading our control. Eloise said, spitting now. They are living on the margins of the law.
Because they were forced there,
Delphine snapped.
Just like these terrorists, Eloise shot back. That is always the excuse. They attack our country, bring hatred back on Francophones like us, all for their own selfish reasons, and then they say it was forced on them.
Behind her through the large window onto the studio, Delphine could see some of the cameras, slow like primordial beasts, shifting as the segment on the stage ended. She couldn't let Eloise get back on camera to spew this hate. How could she have been so wrong about her, Delphine wondered.
What have you done, Eloise?
Delphine whispered. The snow had stopped falling, finally, but the drifts were still deep enough to make walking tough, and Vivi's pants were soaked through. She had swept a branch behind her when she started out to at least obscure the tracks, but 5 hours in, she was betting on no one bothering to follow this far. She was wrong. Something bounced off her forehead, and Vivi stepped back, pulling her knife in the same fluid motion as her eyes rose to see a wild-eyed clone crouching on a branch above her head, another pinecone in her hand.
You are good,
Helena said conversationally.
But I think you not love wilderness.
Vivi didn't lower her knife. What are you doing here?
Came to see if you are okay.
Helena didn't move, didn't take her eyes off Vivi's.
My niece, she was worried.
Vivi cursed internally. She knew she shouldn't have said that thing to Kira about growing up to be a spy. Don't be nice, she reminded herself. Look, she said. I just need some space, okay? It's all been kind of a shock. Helena nodded. She still had some dried blood around her mouth, Vivi noted with a repressed shudder, and her hair was wild and she was perfectly balanced on that branch like a fucking animal.
Yes, I understand. I was like you once.
I too was trained killing machine,
Helena said. I'm not... She was, actually, and it was something Vivi normally felt a degree of pride in, but it certainly wasn't all she was.
I also work for people who told me what to think, what to believe,
Helena went on. From her tone, she could have been soliloquizing, telling the uncaring trees her life story, except for that gimlet glare on Vivi.
I came to tell you, you can change.
Vivi scoffed before she could stop herself, but Helena went on as if she hadn't heard.
I change. I meet my sestras. Now I have family. I have this word I like. Autonomy. I think what I like, I do what I like.
She grinned, the brownish blood stains like gruesome face paint.
But most important is family.
A pause.
You are Sastra too.
Vivi swallowed. She had to wait a moment before she could answer properly. I would like that, she said. It was so hard to say. But right now, it's just too much. I have to go to my own place for a while. It's not about the job. That's over, anyway. That was hard to say, too. Can't really be a spy when everyone knows your face. But I need some time alone to sort things out. She shut her mouth before she said too much, and stood there staring up into the trees, willing Helena to believe her. It felt like a long time before Helena stood, balancing easily on that thick branch, as if she were barefoot instead of in clunky, pink-spangled snow boots that Vivi guessed had once belonged to Allison.
Go think, then,
she said graciously.
We will be waiting.
And as she disappeared back into the forest, the trace of shiny pink flickering between the trees, Vivi had time to wonder if that was an invitation or a threat.
An excellent question, a voice said from the doorway. What have you done, General?
Delphine whirled. Cosima was leaning against the doorframe, one chunky booted ankle crossed over the other.
Is this her?
Eloise asked, her voice unnervingly close to Delphine's ear.
Is this your wife? Or can you even tell them apart?
Delphine spluttered something incoherent, but Cosima just tisked.
Ugly words from someone Delphine told me was on our side. But you aren't, are you, General?
She tilted her head. Eloise's hand came down hard on Delphine's shoulder, and at the same time, the affectation of ease left Cosima's face. That told Delphine she was in trouble even before she felt the cold steel of a blade against her neck. Cosima raised her hand slowly.
Listen.
The door banged open behind her, and the production assistant from before barged in. Delphine felt Eloise's hands whip away from her.
Miss Thibault, you have 2 minutes. We'd like to get you settled on the set now.
There was a moment that felt like forever.
Fine, Eloise said. My colleague here can come watch me from the set, correct?
Of course,
the younger woman said, raising her eyes briefly from her iPad.
But we do need to get go...
She stopped, staring at Cosima.
Are you... You're a clone, aren't you?
Cosima's mouth dropped open. Delphine could see her struggling against the years of hiding. Cosima glanced around, her eyes lighting on Eloise, who was edging toward the door.
Yes, yes, I am a clone. In fact, I came here just to do an interview with you.
A manic gleam came into the production assistant's eyes, and she tapped the mouthpiece hooked around her head and started muttering into it.
Cosima,
Delphine whispered.
You don't have to.
Great, the production assistant said. We're all set. She cast a critical eye over Cosima's face.
No time for makeup, so yours will have to do. If you two could follow me.
With that, she turned and marched out the door, Eloise close in her wake, and Cosima followed behind her, shoulders squared as if she were going into the arena. Neck still tingling from the edge of Eloise's blade, Delphine trailed after. Art was tied to a chair in an apartment. Actually, a condo. Not an empty warehouse, not a back room in some skeezy dive bar. This place looked very photoshoot ready, down to the spheres and long grasses centerpiece on the table, like it was staged for an open house or something. Art knew he was just trying to distract himself from the depth of the shit pile he was in. The spy had lit up yet another cigarette and gone back to fiddling with the small cooler in the corner next to the flat-screen TV. When he stood up, he was holding a syringe awkwardly in the hand with the brace on the wrist. Art braced himself. What was it going to be? Something painful? Something fatal? A truth serum, maybe? Sweat trickled down Art's back. The CIA must have some incredible drugs.
He didn't want to tell them about Charlotte, about anyone, but especially not Charlotte.
Davis walked over to Art's chair, smiling in a way that might have passed for genial on a different face.
I thought about just injecting you with this and letting you figure it out as you go,
he said, holding the needle too close to Art's face.
I really should.
He let it hang for a long moment. Art was pretty sure the drop of mystery medicine shimmering on the end of the syringe was deliberate.
But,
Davis said at last, whipping the syringe away,
I need to hold this out as a bargaining chip just in case Vivi gives me some difficulty about handing over the weapon. And now I find I don't really want to wait that long to tell you about it. I think you'd like to know.
He gave Art another long, considering look, and belatedly the situation clicked together in Art's head. Davis was enjoying this. Art immediately rolled his eyes.
Whatever.
Davis laughed.
You wouldn't be so blasé if you knew what was in this. Look, man,
Art said, taking blasé as his new middle name.
You know I was a Toronto cop, right? You know I was one of the first to uncover the clones. Whatever you've got, I don't think it's gonna beat the guy with the tail, or the maggot spy bots, or the psychotic Ukrainian motorcyclist assassin.
He sent a silent apology to Helena. He wished he had a psychotic Ukrainian motorcyclist assassin with him right now.
So I'm sure whatever you've got there is gnarly and horrible, and I won't like it.
He shrugged against the restraints.
Just let me know when you decide.
Davis's smile had become a rictus. He dropped into a crouch in front of Art, shoving the syringe in his face again.
Oh, this virus won't do anything to you. You won't even know you've got it. At least that's the theory.
The old man shrugged.
You're a bit of a test case, I'm afraid. There could be some adverse effects that weren't predicted, but what we are sure of is that you'll be highly contagious. As soon as you get close to one of those clones that you care so much about, they'll catch it.
Art was trying hard to keep his expression nonchalant, but his guts were roiling.
There will be a longish incubation period without symptoms to give them a chance to infect all their friends, and then they will start to die.
It won't happen, Art told himself, his hands twisting in their ties behind his back.
Cosima and Delphine will find a cure. They understand isolation protocols and they can find an antidote.
Davis was still staring at him, waiting for a reaction.
So I'll move, Art said with a shrug. I'm sure CBP can send me to Calgary or something.
Davis laughed with more feeling this time. He must have heard some of Art's horror in his voice.
And you'll pass the virus to other non-clone carriers, and they will pass it to others, a pandemic that no one will know about or care about because all it will do is eliminate the clones.
Art pretended to consider.
Great plan,
he said finally, nodding.
Seems like it will work. Why aren't you doing it already?
Davis scowled.
Wiping out the clones is a nice side benefit. It closes off some loose ends I was very unhappy to inherit when I took this job. But you must see that it's of limited usefulness.
Art raised a questioning eyebrow.
There are only so many clones,
Davis said, waving his hand dismissively.
And then they're gone. And this particular virus is useless. Okay,
Art said, not having to feign bafflement. Davis stared at him.
You don't know about the weapon? Didn't your friends find Nathaniel's copy?
Art shrugged with as much nonchalance as he could manage.
I don't stick around for the science stuff, not my department.
Davis scowled.
No need for you to know. The point is that Valdez has something I need, and I expect her to trade it for you. This is an absolute imperative of our national security. I'm sure you understand.
Art did. Sure, the U.S. would want to have access to the Origin tool in hopes of reverse engineering any bio attack launched at them. But in the mind of someone like Davis, it would be all too easy to justify using the weapon preemptively, too. Especially, and the horror crept up his spine, if it couldn't be traced.
Anyway,
Davis sounded almost jovial, stubbing out the remains of his cigarette and tapping a new one from the pack.
In case your life isn't enough to convince Valdez to bring me the weapon, I'm hoping she'll be more amenable in exchange for you not being a viral time bomb for her people. Wouldn't Vivi bring the weapon to you anyway?
Art asked, wondering where the fuck Vivi was right now.
Doesn't she still work for you? Hypothetically, yes,
Davis mused.
But I am concerned that she may have gotten some dangerous ideas over the last few days. For all I know, she has gone rogue. And in any case, she's not technically in my department. I would much rather she gave the weapon to me than to her handler.
He inhaled smoke and smiled, letting it out through his teeth.
Art tried not to choke.
Besides,
Davis said, considering the noxious tip of his cigarette,
at this point, Vivi is an unredeemable liability for me and for the agency. Whether or not she has the weapon, I must have her.
The intercom buzzed.
And there she is,
Davis said. He placed his cigarette on the edge of the plate he'd been using as an ashtray and slipped the syringe into his breast pocket.
Sit tight.
Cosima followed Eloise's military posture into the studio, her heart thudding. She thought she might faint and made herself count breaths and watch her feet as she stepped up onto the stage and into the hot lights. There were a lot of people in the studio. A lot of people with headphones and tablets and now, more and more with neither, trickling in from nearby offices to stand and watch. Cosima could almost hear the word clone on their lips, could almost see the whisper spreading through them. She gulped for air. Her eyes, roaming the studio, latched onto Delphine's face, taut with anxiety. And Cosima snapped back into herself. Across from her, Eloise was already talking.
Yes, Karen, I have gotten further reports about the situation in that village in Quebec. The source of that disturbing footage we've all seen. It seems that the clones went there to meet with separatist terrorists and then instigated violence.
That's not true. Cosima's voice leaped out louder than she expected. She froze, but her mind remained hyper-aware of everyone slowly turning to look at her. The inaudible currents ran from earpiece to earpiece around the room, and then the cameras moved in response to them, turning their shiny glare toward her. Cosima knew she shouldn't be looking into those beady lenses, but she couldn't pull her eyes away.
That's right, we have a clone, one of the very few to agree to public interviews, here to discuss these accusations. The newscaster's voice was clear enough to break through, but still Cosima couldn't move. Everyone could see her. This was 100 times worse than her dissertation defense. Somehow she managed to turn her head toward the newscaster, but it was the gleam in Eloise's eyes that snapped her out of her panic.
It's not true, she said again, trying to articulate around a tongue that felt awkward and thick. The clones didn't instigate the riots.
So what really happened out in that village?
Cosima opened her mouth, but Eloise was already speaking.
As I said before, this is a village of known terrorists and terrorist sympathizers, including the suspect from the recent bombing of a major Canadian research facility.
Was that a trap? Did Eloise know that she had been accused of that? Did she know she'd been exonerated?
The facility was bombed by one of its staff members, she interrupted, because he was horrified by the project your department was paying him to execute.
Eloise laughed.
I'm sorry, but this is a little far-fetched.
Oh? Cosima flashed back, starting to forget about all the other people watching.
Far-fetched like a secret research program on human clones? Because I'm living proof that's true.
Why don't you tell us what the Grit Lab was working on with funding from your department? The interviewer turned back to Eloise, and for the first time she appeared slightly unsettled, but she recovered quickly.
We work on all sorts of technology relevant to national security and keeping Canadians safe.
Canadians like the ones in that Quebec village?
Cosima could feel the confidence flooding back into her along with the anger.
Terrorists or not, they deserve due process, a trial, not a customized epidemic.
A customized, the newscaster began, probably searching for a way to reframe the concept for her listeners, but Eloise talked over her.
That's preposterous,
she said.
Utterly preposterous, and there are questions of national security involved as well.
There are definitely national security concerns when the Canadian military is developing secret weapons and using them on their own citizens.
Cosima flashed back.
Those separatists don't even want to be Canadian citizens.
Eloise snarled and then caught herself.
Not that we would do that anyway, of course.
We'll know soon enough, Cosima said.
She paused to take a deep breath and risked letting her eyes skim the audience. They were silent now, waiting for what she had to say instead of staring at her because she was a clone. A Ministry of Defense staffer was arrested at that Quebec village you're so fond of, and he's already telling the cops all about your involvement. The horrified expression that passed across Eloise's face was brief, but very visible.
Maybe you shouldn't have sold out your allies, General,
Cosima whispered, leaning forward. Eloise drew herself up.
I am a decorated general of the Canadian military,
she announced, eyes flashing.
Are you going to believe me or this failed experiment?
Cosima almost laughed. She had, after all, been called so much worse in her time. Better a failed experiment than an angry bigot. Allison rolled her shoulders one last time, took a deep breath, and got in character. Just in time, because the door to the condo building opened. The man behind it was middle-aged on a generous estimate, with the gray, papery skin of a habitual smoker, a brace on one wrist, and a massive bruise across his forehead.
Miss Valdez.
Just tell me what you want,
Allison said tightly. She thought her U.S. accent came out quite well, considering.
I want the weapon, the program. You know you have to bring it in anyway. Why not give it to me?
I want to see the hostage.
He's upstairs,
Davis said, inclining his head.
Shall we? It will be a more private area for our discussions.
Allison spat out a laugh and took a step back.
Walk in there? No way. Bring him down.
It's hardly convenient,
Davis cajoled, taking a step forward himself.
And this, as you see, is a respectable apartment building.
Don't you know? Allison answered. I'm a clone. There's nothing respectable about me.
She pulled out her phone.
You want the weapon? Bring Art down, or I call the paparazzi to blockade this apartment and tell the world exactly what you're up to.
Art, is it?
Davis cocked his head, then chuckled.
How quaint that you think I'm afraid of bad press.
He sighed.
You aren't Valdez, and you don't have the weapon, do you?
I have it right here,
Allison said, taking a step back as she held out a flash drive.
Vivi's not available, but she left it with us.
Davis considered.
I highly doubt that. No, I think you're useless to me. And useless to Valdez, too, or she would be here to protect you. Oh, well. I'll have to hope she has enough contact with people who have contact with you to get my gift eventually.
He yanked something shiny from his breast pocket.
Shall I tell you what this will do to you?
Allison screamed, and Donnie stepped out from beside the door and whacked Davis with a snow shovel. Davis stumbled to his knees, the syringe still in his bandaged hand, and lunged at Allison's feet. Allison jumped back again. Davis was fumbling at his pocket with his left hand.
Hit him again, Donnie!
Allison yelled, but Davis had pulled out a small gun and pointed it directly at Donnie's chest.
No!
Screamed Allison. And that was when someone whirled out of the shadows and slammed a hold onto Davis's left arm, wrenching the gun away from Donnie and then levering on the pressure. Allison heard the crack and Davis grunting, a surprisingly muted reaction. The gun clattered to the ground and Charlotte went after it.
The syringe!
Allison gasped.
Careful, Charlotte!
Are you all right?
Donnie asked, running to Allison's side.
Of course I'm all right, Donnie! Grab him!
But Davis had stumbled back to his feet.
The fuck is wrong with you clones?
He barked.
I guess you all got the gene for violence, didn't you?
You're the one with the gun and the syringe, bro,
Charlotte said, dodging back as Davis lunged dizzily at her, waving the syringe.
See? Even if we admit your premise on a genetic predisposition to violence. Charlotte!
Allison ground out.
Shut up.
Donnie went in swinging again, but Davis dodged and went after his hand with the syringe, forcing Donnie to twist back awkwardly.
I don't need you people,
Davis panted, backing into the building.
This?
He shook the syringe at them.
This will take care of you one way or another.
He flashed his wrist by the door, opened it, slid in, and pulled it shut before Donnie could stop him.
It's locked!
Donnie yelled, banging on it ineffectually.
Push all the bells, see if someone will let us in.
Allison ordered and turned her attention to Charlotte.
You were amazing, sweetie, she said. Now get back in the car.
Three floors above, Sarah was crouched in front of the door Davis had come out of when Allison buzzed, working her lockpicks.
Art?
Jessica called softly, pressed against the door above Sarah's head.
Are you in there?
Shh, Sarah said.
Don't know if he has other goons in there.
Jessica.
They heard a thump from within.
Art!
Jessica whispered frantically.
Are you all right?
We'll find out in a second,
Sarah said, giving the picks a final twist and pushing the door open. Art was tied to a chair, but he didn't look as though he'd been worked over. Just as Jacetta registered that, she heard the sound of a door echoing up the stairwell from below.
He's coming,
Sarah said, brushing past her.
Let's get Art out of here. They're handcuffs,
Art said, as she made for his wrists.
Sarah, you've got to get out of here. We've got this, Art,
Sarah said, pulling out her picks.
You think I'm ditching you after all this time? Sarah, that maniac has a virus that kills anyone with your genome. Get out of here. That maniac's not here right now, is he?
Sarah asked, but her eyes flicked worriedly up to Jacetta's. Just then, she heard the pounding begin on the stairs.
He's coming,
Jacetta hissed and drew her gun.
I've almost got it,
Sarah whispered.
Too late,
Art grunted.
Sarah, get out. Go!
Jacetta pulled herself up next to the doorway as Davis's footsteps approached, but instead of him bursting in as she expected, there was a hiss, and then the world exploded into a flash of light and noise.
Ah!
Jacetta heard herself yelling and stopped. There had been no impact. She ran her hand down her legs to be sure. A flashbang, just a flashbang. She blinked as rapidly as she could, and her vision emerged from the shreds of afterimage just in time to see Davis leaning over Art, syringe in hand, as Art strained away as far as he could get.
No!
Jacetta yelled, but Davis was already plunging the needle into Art's shoulder and depressing it when she shot him in the head.
Oh no,
Sarah whispered.
Run, Sarah,
Art yelled.
Tell Charlotte not to come home. Tell her to stay away from me.
And we're on commercial, the news director said, once a pair of Mounties had escorted a still-seething Eloise off the stage in handcuffs. It turned out not everyone who had crowded into the studio was there to gawk at the clone. Jay had convinced the RCMP that Kurtzman's claims about the general had enough merit to warrant having a couple of plainclothes officers on hand while Cosima pushed Eloise to reveal her true colors. The fact that she had done so on national television was just icing on the cake. The news director didn't even wait for the general's angry shouts to be cut off by the studio door before turning to Cosima.
That was amazing. I know you've been through a lot, but would you mind sticking around for a few minutes to talk us through some of this?
Cosima opened her mouth to say no, and then she thought of Eloise talking about the clone-incited riot. She remembered all the times she had told conferences they couldn't film her presentation because she was afraid someone would see her and realize she was identical to someone else. She found Delphine in the dimness beyond the lights and saw her nod.
Okay,
Cosima said, wiping away any stray moisture from her cheeks with the back of her hand.
Okay, why not? But could you bring my wife up here, too? She knows as much about it as I do.
Is Sarah gone?
Art asked as soon as Jacetta got off the phone from calling in the shooting.
I think so, Jacetta said, which means we're going to have to wait for the cavalry to get you out of those cuffs.
I don't care about these cuffs. You sure she's gone?
Jacetta checked her phone. Yes, she bugged out as soon as she saw you get stabbed. She's on her way back to the house with Allison, Donnie, and Charlotte.
Charlotte was here?
She was in the car, nowhere near you. You have got to relax, Art. You don't want to pull a shoulder socket, believe me. Art's eyes were going red and runny, and Jacetta eyed him with concern.
Are you starting to show symptoms of whatever that horrible thing was? Are you...
I'm fine,
Art said flatly.
There are no symptoms. Not for me. Probably.
He added,
remembering what Davis had said about him being a test case.
But if I get near a clone, I kill them. Oh my God,
Jessica said involuntarily.
I'm so sorry, Art said. You're probably infected now, too. You have to call your people back and tell them we need quarantine procedures. Otherwise, it's going to leap from carrier to carrier until, at some point, it gets to a clone.
Do you really think the incubation period is that short? Jessica asked after she hung up. She eased herself to the floor with her back against Art's legs to wait for the hazmat team.
I don't know, but I'm not taking any chances,
Art said.
Charlotte.
He stopped and swallowed.
Jessica, I'm so sorry. I know this is going to put a damper on your career, well, everything in your life.
Maybe not one thing.
It's fine, Jessica said. None of the clones were infected. They'll find a cure or a vaccine, and we'll manage in the meantime.
She tilted her head up to see Art glaring down at her suspiciously.
We'll manage?
He asked.
Long-term isolation with an unknown communicable disease?
It might not take that long, Jessica said, easing herself back up to standing. Didn't you say Cosima and her wife are geniuses at this stuff? And hey, maybe some time off from work wouldn't be such a bad thing. Art was now staring at her in total disbelief.
Time off from work?
I just think there could be an upside, Jessica went on. That is, as long as it had come out so smoothly until now. She sighed.
Do you think we might be in isolation together?
Watching Art's expression change slowly and beautifully was worth it.
Now that you mention it,
he said,
some time off does sound pretty good.
In that case, Jessica said carefully, maybe we should make sure that I'm really infected. She leaned over very slowly, giving him plenty of time to say no. Kissing someone who was tied to a chair was definitely against department protocol. But the circus was going to arrive any minute, and it might be a while before they got another chance.
Ah, what the hell?
Art whispered right before their lips met. Two days later.
Hey, how's Art?
Kira asked as she came down the steps into the basement apartment at Chez Coffin that she was sharing with Charlotte for a few weeks.
Same, Charlotte said with a sigh. He says hi.
She turned her phone so Kira could see the Skype link to the isolation chamber and then said goodbye to her dad and hung up.
How was work?
She asked as Kira plopped next to her on the couch.
Ugh. It's not work,
Kira said.
It's cleanup. I don't know. I thought Gene Keep and Dr. Bai were so great. The perfect way to do good in the world. And now Dr. Bai has been arrested, and we find out he was selling genomes to the DOD and pressuring people to contribute so badly that they modified their DNA to crash his computer. I don't know.
How's Emmeline? Charlotte asked slyly.
Did that turn out to be a real date you guys went on yesterday or not?
Kira threw a pillow at her and got up, but based on the color in her face, Charlotte was going with real date.
You want a beer?
Kira asked from in front of the mini fridge.
Sure, Charlotte said. Hey, do you think your mom has forgiven me for outing them?
Kira came back with the bottles of swanky microbrew she had swiped from Kofin's fridge. She took her first swig before answering.
I don't think forgive is the right word, she said. She definitely hasn't forgiven me yet. For any of it, really. But she is trying really hard to understand and listening to me as an adult.
She shrugged, embarrassed.
It's kind of amazing, actually. I'm still not sure it was the right thing to do,
Charlotte said, looking down.
It was. It was definitely the right decision. Kira said, touching Charlotte's arm. They might never fully accept it, but sooner or later they're all going to realize that they're better off now.
I don't know, Charlotte said.
All those videos of people who didn't know finding out suddenly?
Yeah, Kira agreed. Some of them had been awful. People losing their jobs, sometimes their families, while their entire sense of identity was rearranged.
I just keep imagining what it would be like to find out like that, without support, on the news.
Charlotte buried her face in her hands.
I should have thought it through more carefully.
Hey, Kira said.
You made the best decision you could at the time. Remember that Cosima was about to go to jail? And besides, you were trapped. Our aunts were trapped, even if they wouldn't admit it. And don't you think these other clones will be happy, eventually, to know this about themselves?
Maybe, Charlotte said doubtfully. Raised self-aware, it was hard for her to imagine that kind of upheaval.
They should have help, though.
She sat up suddenly.
Maybe that's what we should do. I mean, now that your internship is over, we should set up an organization to support all the newly self-aware clones.
Awesome, Kira said, holding out her fist for a bump.
You know, she went on after a pause, I was wondering if that was part of what went wrong with Vivi.
You mean the fact that the way she found out was so difficult? Kira nodded.
Dana's really upset about it, feels guilty. Helena never found any traces of her, right?
No, Kira said, drooping. Dana wasn't the only one who was upset.
And if Helena couldn't find her, nobody?
Nobody. But lots of snow, and maybe animals. Or maybe she's just a super spy, and she got away.
Because she wanted to leave. She just couldn't deal with it, Charlotte said.
Yeah, I mean, I know my mom and a lot of my aunts found out under difficult circumstances, but there's difficult circumstances, and then there's while spying in a foreign country and learning that your agency has betrayed you.
Charlotte nodded and took a sip of beer. Well, I hope she's okay.
Me too, Kira said and stood.
Shall we join the party?
The party was in full swing by the time they got upstairs. Charlotte drifted toward Allison and Donnie, who were telling Delphine about their contract to do a reality show called Clones at Home, to show that clones could have a normal, family-centered, suburban life just like anyone else.
It's going to be so important, you know, just to show people that we can be normal, too.
Allison was gushing while Delphine nodded. Charlotte moved on before she was forced to snark on Aunt Allison's mood. In the doorway of the kitchen, Cosima was nodding enthusiastically along with something Dana was saying.
I think it would be perfect, because I've already published some ethnographic pieces about our experiences. I just always had to call them twin studies.
Dana grimaced and Cosima laughed.
I don't know why I didn't think of that. But now that we can say they're about clones, we can go much bigger. And I really think having your Evo-Devo expertise along with my social science approach would make for a super interesting paper.
That would be amazing, Cosima said, as Charlotte scooched past them to get into the kitchen, where a tray of iced cupcakes was sitting on the counter. Just as she reached for one, Artie dodged by her and grabbed it, taking another with his other hand, hopefully for his twin instead of himself. Charlotte yelled after him, even though she knew it was futile, and then snagged one for herself, hoping they were spiked with something interesting, then moved into the greenhouse.
Have you seen this?
Sarah was asking Helena, cracking up as she showed her a website on her phone. Charlotte leaned over their shoulders to look.
What is that?
She asked, licking at the icing on her cupcake.
It's Crystal's blog site, or vlog site, or whatever she calls it. She's finally decided being a clone is worth it for the hype.
As Helena nodded her appreciation, Sarah passed the phone back to Charlotte, who saw that it was a which clone are you makeup quiz.
Ew,
she said, passing it back.
Did I tell you?
Helena said casually.
They have been asking for my memoir.
What?
Who?
Sarah asked, sitting up.
You didn't tell us anything about that, Matehead.
Agents,
Helena said, waving her hands.
Publishers. I don't know names.
That's amazing, Aunt Helena, Charlotte said politely, wondering what on earth was in that book.
What about you, kiddo?
Sarah asked, reaching back to poke Charlotte in the ribs.
Any big plans now that you can finally tell people the truth about yourself, yada yada?
Charlotte smiled, encouraged that Sarah did indeed seem to have gotten over it.
Mainly, I'm just helping Aunt Cosima and Aunt Delphine on the vaccine work.
Of course,
Sarah said more soberly as they all thought of Art and Jacinta waiting to be made safe.
Hey, Aunt Helena?
Charlotte said, taking advantage of the pause. What happened to Vivi, do you think? Is she all right?
Helena stared into the distance.
I do not know,
she said.
But I hope so.
Vivi emerged from the snow-covered woods to see a road and buildings. It was only a tiny hamlet, remote and practically off-grid, but it was on the Vermont side of the border. The lack of cell phone coverage worked in Vivi's favor because there was still a payphone in the general store, and she was able to get a decent meal and an excellent slice of pie while she waited. It was almost 4 hours after she made her call that an unusually clean and new-looking car pulled into the center of town, stopping only long enough for Vivi to get into the passenger side.
Davis is dead,
Arun said before anything else. Good, Vivi said.
Come mierda.
Oh, so you did manage to pick up some French.
Vivi wanted to hug him, but she rolled her eyes instead.
Did you get it?
Arun wasn't looking at her, eyes flitting between the road and the rearview mirror. Vivi dropped the tiny drive she had ripped from Kurtzman's lanyard, the one that contained the virus customizer, into his waiting hand. Not only that, she said with satisfaction, I'm presumed dead. No need to mention that Helena knew, not yet. Being a clone could still be an advantage. The car turned around, drove back down the main street, and disappeared into the snowy landscape, headed south.
You're listening to Orphan Black, the next chapter, starring Tatiana Maslany. Produced by Realm, your portal to another world. Orphan Black, the next chapter is written by Malka Older, Lindsay Smith, Madeline Ashby, Mishell Baker, E.C. Myers, and Heli Kennedy. Produced by Marco Palmieri and executive produced by Molly Barton, Julian Yap, David Fortier, Ivan Shebeg, and Carrie Appleyard. In partnership with Boat Rocker Media and BBC America. Audio produced, sound designed, and edited by Amanda Rose Smith. Based on the television series Orphan Black, produced by Temple Street, a division of Boat Rocker Studios. The theme music is by Two Fingers.